we'll go ahead. So point number one, what are the presentations that you encounter in your day-to-day practice with regard to dementia? Usually, most of the people come and complain that they have memory issues, and most of them are not having dementia. Commonly, they are worried well. That means the patient is extremely anxious, that the patient is having a dementia syndrome. How do you differentiate from a worried well from a dementia or having a significant cognitive impairment? Is ask with regard to what are the complaints that the patient's having, why they think that they are having memory complaints. Most of the time, these people would say that perhaps they're going to shopping and forgetting things that they're supposed to buy, but on the way, on return, they remembered like these things are forgotten. Or perhaps they entered into a room and then apparently noticed for no reason, and then later they recall that they went to that particular room to get a particular object, kind of thing, where the complaint is more attention deficit. They are not concentrated on what their task, and these things are more commonly seen in people who are anxious or maybe who are stressful work at work, or sometimes with depression. So you need to see whether the patient's having depression in these kind of disorders and anxiety, and need to treat those conditions. And there's another thing which is again not a cognitive problem, but may come with memory complaints, which is historical dementia, where people having a conversion disorder that they are having a memory problem, but actually they don't have a memory issue. Those patients, how you differentiate that they come and complain, and when you are doing a regular conversation, perhaps you would be able to see that the patient is having or reporting complaints with regard to the memory. But when you're during the conversation, you may see that it is kind of a normal memory, that they are nicely correlating to the events. But when you are trying to do a trying to perform a cognitive assessment, these people trying to give erroneous answers voluntarily to create a situation that they have a cognitive problem. So those are the historical dementias. Now the people who are having cognitive problems can have a spectrum where you have mild cognitive impairment, MCIs, where they have actual cognitive deficits, but they are very slight and noticeable though, and that doesn't cause any activities of any problem to their day-to-day activities. So there are mild cognitive impairments. There are various mild cognitive impairments typified according to the cognitive domain that the symptom being affected. Broadly, they are categorized into amnestic MCIs, where their episodic memory is affected, and non-amnestic MCIs, where their main cognitive domain is not related to the episodic memory, but to the other domains. And then to the dementia proper, where they have actual decline in cognitive functions and which affects their day-to-day activities. Now, point two, dementia is an umbrella term. It used to define several clinical syndromes which impair memory and behavior, thinking and other cognitive skills. And the broad categories which can give rise to dementias are neurodegeneration, that would be our topic proper, but then neuroinfections like various CNS infections, HIV, then metabolic like hypothyroidism, organ failures, renal liver problems, and then electrolyte disturbances like hyponatremia, then structural brain damage like tumors, strokes, and then toxic problems like ethanol. All these things can give rise to a cognitive impairment, but we are going to talk today on neurodegenerative conditions. Now, neurodegenerative dementias are broadly proteinopathies where they have abnormal proteins. It's Dr. Damit Lienege also explained the synucleinopathies in the Parkinson's disease. Now, usually these proteins are normally folded in normal functioning body. Like in this cartoon, you see there's an elephant origami of an elephant, which is to represent the normal protein. But when they are misfolded or abnormally folded, that's like the paper ball. And these misfold proteins are extremely sticky, and they tend to aggregate in the brain. And that aggregations can lead to neurodegeneration and then dementia. Now, there are common commonly noted abnormal proteins, like in Alzheimer's disease, the commonest pathology is amyloid. Of course, you can see the tau proteins as well there. And then in frontotemporal dementias, they have frontotemporal lobe degeneration pathology, which is predominantly tau, and then FTLD pathology with predominant TDP43 protein, and then FUS FAS protein. And in Lewy body dementias, and then the Parkinson's disease dementia, synuclein protein is the one which is abnormally accumulated. Point number three, it's extremely difficult to phenotype a dementia syndrome without having a cognitive, without having a sensible knowledge about the cognitive assessment. So you need to have a reasonable understanding about the cognitive assessment, because neurological examination or any blood test or perhaps even including imaging might not give a clue or to clue to the phenotype without having the presenting symptom being analyzed cognitively. You need to have a good understanding about this patient's general premorbid functioning before developing symptoms. What was the level of education? What kind of employment that the patient was doing? What were the significant relationships, the family relationships with regard to the friends and office-related relationships? These things will give us an insight into the patient's functioning, the behavior, and their hobbies, these kind of understanding. And then at the onset of the syndrome, what are the symptoms that the patient had at the initial presentation, and how these symptoms progressed or deteriorated over the time, give us some insight into the dementia syndrome. You need to interview both the patient and the informant, because sometimes the patients are ignorant or unaware about their cognitive symptoms, and sometimes they may say no to your questions. So the information is extremely helpful to get an insight into the actual deficits that the patient experience. Of course, the family history and the risk factors are really helpful, especially if there's genetic associations, and then to get the support of the family with regard to the management of these patients. Concomitant illnesses, the medication, give us some background history where sometimes the drugs like benzodiazepines, tricyclic antidepressants can adversely affect for the patient's cognition, and you might have to change this medication to improve symptoms. And then the functioning of the patient, activities of daily living and driving, give us some insight into the planning. Now, the specific domains of cognition is the key to typify a dementia syndrome. And these assessments are done in various cognitive scales. Most of you are comfortable or aware mini mental state examination. And that is something very short time taking, 30-point questionnaire. And there are other cognitive scales like Montreal Cognitive Assessment or MoCA, which is available and validated in Sinhala and Tamil as well, and Addenbrooke Cognitive Scale Cognitive Examination is, which is available in the revised form. Now, there are various advantages and disadvantages of these cognitive scales, but I'm trying to explain few important cognitive domains which you need to have an understanding. Attention and orientation is something important at the beginning of any cognitive skill. If the patient doesn't have a good attention or oriented, then it's very difficult to continue with the rest of the cognitive assessment. So you would ask the orientation, the time, place and person with regard to the orientation. And there are a lot of attention tests which the commonest available is a series of 7 subtraction test from 100. You would expect the patient to do at least 5 subtractions. But sometimes the patients are not good in calculating, or the education level is not that very good. On those patients, you can use asking the months of the year in the reverse order, or days of the week from Sunday, Saturday, like backward, as a reasonable test with regard to the patient's attention. Then the memory is one of the most important thing, especially in the amnestic syndrome or the patients who have memory problems. There are various domains in memory. Broadly, it is categorized into episodic memory, working memory, and semantic memory. In the episodic memory, it is regarded as a personally experienced events, where various events related to your personal experience. Now, if I ask, and then the newly encountered information is considered as anterograde, and whatever recalled as the past events are considered as a retrograde memory. Now, working memory is a very short-term memory where you retain a little piece of information for a temporary use, something like that you read a telephone number and then dial it without writing it down. That is something where you retain that memory for a very short period, and then if you asked that telephone number after about 5 minutes, you have completely forgotten it. The semantic memory is the memory related to the meaning of various words and your general fund of knowledge, like what is the largest continent, or what is the population of the country, or what is the language used in this particular nation, or this kind of general fund of knowledge is considered as a semantic memory. Now, the language is another important aspect that you need to understand, because certain dementia syndromes can present with predominant language defects. So how do you assess the language? By asking the patient to write things, and then of course with the history taking, you would be able to examine the patient's speech. So what are the things that you would keep a note on? Whether the patient's fluency is better, the prosody, the pronunciations, whether the patient is agrammatic, whether the patient's having articulations problems, and when in the spontaneous speech, whether the patient's having difficulties in finding appropriate words. Now, naming is called anomia, problems with the naming. This is commonly seen in patients with post-stroke aphasia and Alzheimer's disease and semantic dementias. Paraphasic errors are in various categories, where we have phonemic paraphasic errors, where you use a different word which phonemically, pronunciation-wise, in the same. Maybe you use to tell the teacher a cheater. It's phonemically sound, but gives a different idea or may have no meaning into it. These things are, and then the semantic paraphasias, like patients have used, you know that the clock and watch has different meaning, but patient use it interchangeably. Or sometimes patient use broad superordinate paraphasias, where sort of all the kind of animals, you know that when you see a lion, it's a lion, but patient find it difficult to tell it's a lion, but can tell it's as an animal. So those are the paraphasic errors that you would encounter. And then the comprehension, the single word comprehension, where you know what is that the meaning of that particular word, is important, as well as the sentence comprehension. When that word in a different sentence, what is the meaning of that? It accesses sort of different area of the language, and then the conceptual comprehension. Something like if you give some objects, maybe a toy, maybe a watch, maybe a television in front of the patient, and ask what is the equipment that you use to measure the time, and then if the patient can point it towards the watch, that is kind of a conceptual comprehension. And then the repetition of the language is also important. You might have encountered this no ifs, ands, or buts in the MMSC. This is something, an idiom, which is used to check the repetition. Anything you can use, any proverb in our context to check the repetition, because certain language problems can have repetition problems. And then coming to the executive and frontal lobe functions, there are several tests to assess the frontal lobe functions. I would try to name a few. These people have frontal lobe functions, have problems with the planning and judgment, and they have difficulty in problem solving. One important test is the letter fluency. You'd ask in standard cognitive test to give as much as possible, write as much as possible words starts with F, A, S, kind of with those letters. And the people who are having frontotemporal dementias have very poor letter fluency. And the category fluency is where you ask the patient sort of name and much as possible animals or vegetables or fruits, flowers, kind of things. And those category fluency is low in Alzheimer's disease and semantic dementia. The go-no-go task is something to check the impulsivity. You ask the patient, if I clap one, you clap two. And if I clap two, you are not supposed to clap. The patients with frontal and dissecticular syndromes would not be able to do that. And when you clap one, they will clap one or they will clap two. And when you clap two also, they'll clap two or they might keep on clapping. So those are the go-no-go tasks to check the impulsivity. And then the cognitive estimates, something like, you may not know the exact answer, perhaps something like, what is the height of the post box? Perhaps you know that the post box, you don't know the exact answer, but you would be able to sort of recognize it's something like height of a human being. And then you know what is the height of an average human being, and you'll be able to sort of give a good cognitive estimate. And then abstract reasoning. The people, if they were sort of mentioned with a commonly known proverb, like kill two birds with one stone, the person who have executive function problems find it difficult to understand the meaning of this. They would say the exact meaning, what is mentioned in the words, like it is to take one stone and kill two birds kind of thing. So there are problems with abstract reasoning. The apraxia is something important with regard to the assessment, where you have good motor functions in the hand, but they have problems with the planning of these motor functions. Commonly seen in, that means patient is not having a stroke or any coordination problem, but they have difficulty in planning out these motor sequences. These things commonly seen in hand, commonly assessed in hand apraxia, where you ask various gestures to be imitated or to use an imagine object, something like to demonstrate, show me how to get a comb and how to use the comb to brush your hair, or maybe how to take a toothbrush in your hand and brush your teeth. Again, another important apraxia is called orobuccal apraxia, where you get the patient to do some orobuccal movements, something like imitate how to whistle, something like that. And then the last important domain is a visuospatial ability, where you get the patients to do a copying intersecting pentagon, or to draw a wire cube, or to draw the dial of a clock, and then put the two arms to indicate a particular time. If patients are having problems with this, you would be able to easily differentiate whether the patient's having a visuospatial problem. Now, coming to the point four, the commonest type that you all encountered in your day-to-day practice as neurodegenerative disease dementia is Alzheimer's, and that is the late onset Alzheimer's disease, which is over the 65 of age. And this is a progressive amnestic disorder, where you have episodic memory, which is affected, and then the the in the episodic memory also, the anterograde or the newly gathered information is lost more frequently than the remote memory impairment. So these patients may forget what they have taken for the breakfast or what is the thing they have done immediately before coming into the room, but they would recall very elaborately what is the school that they have been to, what is their first job, perhaps when they got married, and what was their sort of young days vacations. They are relatively preserved, they are the retrograde memory. The other important thing is the head turn sign. If you ask something important from that patient related to that person's autobiographical memory, related to that patient's memory, which you expect to remember, something like if the patient is sort of retired, and then if you ask like, when did you get retired and what year, important things related to this patient's life, he might not sure about that sort of answer. So perhaps if there's a spouse or partner by the side of the patient, always turn to that patient to get the confirmation from that partner's face. So that's an important sign with regard to the episodic memory. Of course, they have other domains of memory, executive, language, and visual spatial impairment as well. But the episodic memory is the initial hallmark of the presentation of late onset Alzheimer's disease. Of course, there are rare variants of non-amnestic syndromes of Alzheimer's disease, which can present in the late onset, which are logopenic variant of primary progressive aphasia and posterior cortical atrophy that we are going to describe later. Now, they can have common neuropsychiatric problems, maybe secondary to their memory problems like depression and anxiety. And if they are there, sometimes they may need treatment. Social and emotional functions are generally preserved in Alzheimer's patients. They don't see agitation or psychosis in the early phase of the disease. And this is something very much important to contrast with the behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia that we are going to discuss later. And the pathological hallmarks are seen in the amyloid plaques, which are seen extracellularly, as you see in this cartoon, in this slide, and then neurofibrillary tangles, which are hyperphosphorylated microtubular protein tau, is being gathered inside the nerve cells. So this is a scan, axial scan of the brain, and then the coronal scan of the brain across the medial temporal lobe, especially particularly across the hippocampus. Now, if you can see, this is the left anterior horn, which is also enlarged, but if you compare the right anterior horn, extremely enlarged. And in the coronal cut as well, the anterior horns are largely enlarged. So this indicates the patient is having a hippocampal atrophy, and this is a very nice sign. But in the early phase of the disease, you might not see these things. Sometimes you might have to wait for the late stage. And are there any other markers? Yes. In the Alzheimer's disease, as we discussed, the pathology is Alzheimer's, and then they deposit amyloid beta in the brain. If you do a CSF study, they have reduced amyloid beta and increased total tau and phosphorylated tau proteins. So if you take CSF and do the amyloid beta to phosphorylated tau ratio, this has about 80 to 90% specificity and sensitivity for the amyloid disease pathology. And the other markers, other biomarkers are amyloid beta PET scan, where you have a PET ligand for amyloid beta protein, which is injected, and then do a PET scan and see the deposition of amyloid in the brain, and the tau PET scan. In this cartoon, in the lower right side of the site, you can see in a normal brain, which is amyloid negative PET scan, and a positive scan, there are a lot of red orange areas depositing of the amyloid protein. Now, the treatment of amyloid disease, you need to have a holistic approach, but we are discussing only the specific pharmacological treatment because of the interest of trying. The acetylcholine esterase inhibitors are shown to be useful. Of course, they are not reversing the disease most of the time, they are really helpful to minimize or ameliorate the disease progression. The donepezil, rivastigmine, and galantamine are available, but in the late stage of the disease or moderately severe disease, you can start NMDR agonist, which is memantine. Then the fifth point, the early onset Alzheimer's disease. Now, do we have to take the early onset Alzheimer's disease as a different point? Yes. Why? Because it has a completely different phenotype to the late onset Alzheimer's disease. Now, this is about 5 to 6% of all Alzheimer's cases, so it's not the majority, but it's about 1/3 of the young onset dementias, where we consider the age of onset is less than 65. Now, it is not the early onset Alzheimer's disease is not just the Alzheimer's disease at a young age, or which we used to know the Alzheimer's disease amnestic syndrome, which is not an amnestic syndrome happening in the young age. Typically, most early onset Alzheimer's have problems not in the predominant memory domain, but they have problems with the language, visuospatial, dissociative functions. And when you encounter a patient at young onset Alzheimer's disease, always the clinicians thinks, could this be a familial inherited form? Yeah, it is important to think, but they are not the majority. About 10% of patients with early onset Alzheimer's disease tend to have autosomal dominant family history. And there are several genes, about 20 genes have been described, but very commonly occurred are the amyloid precursor protein or APP and presenilin 1, PSN1, and then the presenilin 2, which is the commonest autosomal dominant inherited, the genetic variant of familial Alzheimer's disease. And these mutations lead to aberrant cleavage and aggregation of the amyloid precursor protein and accumulation of amyloid plaques in the brain. And these familial onset autosomal dominant Alzheimer's diseases usually manifest as an amnestic syndrome typical to the old age group. But the majority, about 90%, are sporadic forms. And of these sporadic forms, majority are non-amnestic variants where your memory domain is not predominantly episodic, but having language problems where you label them as logopenic variant, visuospatial problems where you have label them as posterior cortical atrophy, and sometimes they may mimic behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia, but with Alzheimer's pathology. And sometimes they can have acalculia, a predominant parietal lobe syndrome, and sometimes these patients can have a presentation of corticobasal syndrome as well. Now, logopenic variant of Alzheimer's disease is the most common phenotype of early onset Alzheimer's disease. And we are going to discuss the logopenic variant along with the group of primary progressive aphasias a little later. What is posterior cortical atrophy? It is another common presentation of young onset Alzheimer's disease who have visuospatial and perceptual functions. Now, what are these visuospatial and what is the difference between the perceptual deficits? Visuospatial is your things to relate to your visual world. What are the relative orientation of the objects, where these objects are located? Actually, the where kind of knowledge is considered as the visuospatial. Perceptual means the what kind of knowledge, what you are seeing, what is the color, what is the shape, what kind of object is this? That knowledge is considered as a perceptual deficit. Now, because of these visuospatial and perceptual deficits, these people tend to have a lot of navigation problems. They can have minor car accidents, or they have challenge parking in car parks, tiny slots. They are finding difficult to read things. Perhaps they might complain that the text is sort of jumping from place to place, or they may have problems with the color vision. They may see the colors are faded, not used to sort of be as they are usual pattern. Or they find it difficulty finding objects in front of you. Like people come and complain when they start cooking, they find it extremely difficult to get the spoon or the salt bottle, which Absolutely, they are quite staring at them in front, but when there are a lot of other objects, they find it extremely difficult to find, which is called simultagnosia. And these people are extremely anxious about riding the escalators or judging the speed of the traffic because of their visual spatial knowledge. They find it extremely terrible to enter into a revolving door. These people are challenged, especially if they are entered into a featureless environment. Like if you are entered into a white-tiled bathroom where you find it difficult to locate the edges, these people are quite challenging those environments. And they can have difficulty recognition face as well, which is called prosopagnosia. These people initially go to eye doctor, and then they may have multiple glass changes, but with little success. And because of this, seeing the eye doctors, and they don't think about that, the brain visual functions is lost. Usually, this has a late presentation. Apart from the visual cortex, these people can have the parietal lobe functions affected as well. So they can have the Gerstmann syndrome presentation like acalculia, agraphia, finger agnosia, and left-right disorientation. Also, they can have a bilateral involvement of the visual cortex, can precipitate as Bellin syndrome, where you can get oculomotor apraxia, optic ataxia, and simultagnosia. And they can have reading problems, or they can present with alexia, or they can have problems with performing certain things, although they don't have any motor function deficits, which is called apraxia. We discussed it earlier. Relatively, in comparison to the amnestic variant, these patients have episodic memory preserved. So it is something important to differentiate from the typical Alzheimer's disease. So most of the time, their cognitive functions look great. And their personality and the behavior also not usually affected, something important to differentiate from the frontotemporal dementia. Now, if you see a scan of the brain, you may see that in the posterior cortex, the sulci and gyri atrophied. And that is very nicely demonstrated in a coronal section across the corpus callosum. You can see the occipital cortex is significantly atrophied, relevant to the rest of the area of the brain. And this is a PET scan of posterior cortical atrophy, where you see more posterior cortex are having increased uptake of the PET ligand. Now, point number six, the frontotemporal dementias. This is another interesting group of dementia syndromes, where you have the frontal lobe and the temporal lobe affected. There's two major categories, which is called behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia and the primary progressive aphasia. The behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia have predominant frontal lobe pathology, while the primary progressive aphasia have predominantly temporal lobe pathologies. We are going to discuss the primary progressive aphasia later. So we'll discuss the behavioral variant frontotemporal dementias. This is the commonest FTD. Behavioral variant FTD presents with slowly progressive decline in social and emotional functions. Sometimes these people may not diagnose at the beginning because they are often mistaken for a midlife crisis in their life, sometimes in their 50s or early 60s. They have depression or other psychiatric disorders. This is not a typical age to develop primary psychiatric disorders in these patients. Sometimes they have problems with their executive functioning, so they lose their jobs. Sometimes they can have disinhibition and they can have anticipated marital discords. They may have separated, or sometimes they marry a younger spouse. These marital discords are commonly seen in patients with behavioral variant FTD. They have loss of motivation and apathy. Sometimes you might need to encourage this patient to have a shower or have a wash to keep the cleanliness, to keep the hygiene. You need to encourage this patient. Otherwise, they are completely neglecting on their self-hygiene. And they have lost, demonstrated the loss of empathy, like the feeling for the others, and they have disinhibition. They can have pervasive errors of omissions and commissions. They may abandon family duties. They can approach strangers or violation of interpersonal boundaries inappropriately. They can perform repetitive things, stereotypic, compulsive, or ritualistic. Sometimes they can sort of do the same thing again and again. My last patient had he has a lot of pets at home, and he brings more pets. Now there are about 15 cats at home, cats and dogs at home, and he used to offer meals for them almost like every hour. So those repetitive things are important thing to be not perseveration. And they tactlessly comment on other sensitive things like weight, attractiveness, in otherwise person wouldn't have done. They straightly sort of comment on these things. They ignored family's major events, something like a sort of spouse's birthday or child's some success in an exam. They don't give much respect to that, or perhaps sort of appreciate that, or they trivialize the thing. Depend on the area involved in the frontal lobes, there are various phenotypes. If you are anterior and inferior frontal lobe, which is the orbitofrontal cortex, if it is involved, they might show disinhibition, overeating, they may take a lot of sweets, and they can show compulsivity. The dorsal dorsal subtype, they are the behind and the surface of frontal lobe, if that is involved, they show dysexecutive syndrome and apathy. And if you have frontal, if you have anterior temporal lobe involvement, they lose sympathy and empathy. Now, there are several proteins can give rise to. We discussed that the tau protein, the TDP protein, and the FAS protein can give rise to frontotemporal dementias. And 15% to 20% of frontotemporal dementias are inherited, and there's a non-genetic variant. Three major genes been described: MAPT gene, granulin, GRN gene, and C9 of 72 are three common genes described. The cartoon here is a very complicated one, but which shows various proteins could involve, which could give rise to the frontotemporal dementia. The pharmacological management, there's no any disease modifying therapy so far for the behavioral variant frontotemporal dementias, but you need supportive treatment. Sometimes the overeating, compulsivity, you can treat as a OCD, like with using a SSRI. Apathy, you can use a SNRI like venlafaxine, which activate the noradrenergic properties of receptors. The social disinhibition is extremely difficult to treat, but you need to assure the safety and the dignity of others. Sometimes you might have to use low dose atypical antipsychotics, something like quetiapine or risperidone. There are Alzheimer's pathology also can give rise to behavioral variant FTDs. Of course, you need to have the Alzheimer's biomarkers for that, which we don't have in our country. But in those patients, the acetylcholinesterase inhibitors is useful. Otherwise, these patients are not benefited by our typical Alzheimer's disease treatment, acetylcholinesterase and NMDR treatment, memantine. Point 7. The primary progressive aphasias. That is another umbrella term which groups into, which take have three groups of conditions: the semantic dementia, primary non-fluent aphasia, PNFA, and logophonic aphasia. Now, we can sort of, this nice cartoon shows, the red bucket shows the primary progressive aphasia, the semantic where they have deficiencies in semantic knowledge, but they have preserved grammar and impaired word comprehension, where they are lost word knowledge. And the agrammatic variant, they have impaired grammar, but they have preserved word comprehension. So that is nicely differentiated from the semantic variant. The logopenic variant, we have impaired word finding and impaired repetition, but they have preserved grammar and preserved word comprehension to differentiate from the semantic and the agrammatic variant. So this is an extremely simplified cartoon. And just to give an initiation, how these primary progressive aphasias occurs because of these abnormal proteins deposited in particular sites of the brain. In this first one, where the logopenic variant, where they are deposited predominantly in the left side of the brain, in the posterior temporal and the parietal region. And their pathology is commonly Alzheimer's pathology, where they get amyloid plaques. In the agrammatic variant, they are having problems deposition. The tau pathology, the tau proteins are deposited mainly in the anterior part of the frontal area, where your motor speech is planned, like your supplementary motor cortex, the premotor cortex area, where speech is planned, where you get the agrammatic variant and the language area. The semantic dementias, you have more temporal lobe involvement, and the commonest pathology is TDP43. Now, we are coming to the semantic dementias. In semantic dementias, they present with their language problems, or sometimes their memory-based symptoms, such as difficulty retrieving words or trouble remembering words. Usually, these people have problems with naming things. Anomia is something not specific, though commonly seen in semantic dementias. Sometimes they find it difficult a dog as a dog, but they might call as an animal. Or sometimes they might use a very broader term, something like that place, or that thing, this thing, to mention a thing, because they find it extremely difficult to retrieve that particular word. The most important thing is not that they have the difficulty in retrieving the word, but they don't have the understanding of that particular word as well. Now, if you show a watch to them, they don't know the meaning of that instrument. Like, they don't know that it is used to record the time. So these patients are relatively blind to their extent of their impairment as well, like the Alzheimer's disease patients. How do you categorize from other dementias? By testing the semantic memory. So you do the verbal memory test, and you do a non-verbal memory test as well. If you are having semantic memoria, which is predominantly affecting the about 70% of semantic dementias affecting the left temporal lobe, so they have loss of verbal memory. And about 30%, they start from the right temporal lobe. So they have non-verbal memories. So they may have problems with the remembering face. So show some pictures of famous people that you would otherwise think that the patient should have known of. And then ask to identify. They find it extremely difficult. In the most difficult or extreme version, sometimes even if you show the photo of the person, also, they find it difficult to recognize themselves. So that is how you are checking the non-verbal memory. An important thing is this surface dyslexia and the dysgraphia. This is something that you check, you can see in other dementias as well, but very commonly seen in semantic dementia. In English words, some words are doesn't spelled in the same way it phonate. Y-A-C-H-T is, if you pronounce it as the spelling, it is sometimes pronounced as yatched, but it is actually pronounced as yotch. So if you get this patient to write yotch, they try to write the letters to say to resemble yotch rather than yatch, because they don't have the word meaning of yotch. So they don't have the word meaning, so they try to write Yoch as it write in a person who's not knowing the yoch. Another word is something like debt. The same thing, the reverse. If you give these words a list to read and pronounce, the yoch is pronounced as yach, because they don't have the meaning of the word. And in the semantic dementias, the repetition of words, the language is preserved, and that would help to differentiate it from logopenic primary progressive aphasia. And they have spared fluency and grammar, so they are not agrammatic at the presentation, which is helpful to differentiate from the non-fluent agrammatic variant of the primary progressive aphasia. In the semantic dementias, in this the MR scan, you can see that the left temporal lobe is markedly atrophied in comparison to the other areas. And in the PET scan shows increased uptake in the left temporal lobe, in the lateral and inferior. Now, point 8. Primary non-fluent agrammatic primary progressive aphasia, where you lose the grammatic component of the language. They have a difficulty producing a complete grammatical sentence. It is also demonstrated in the written language. So, extremely helpful if you can find some emails of these patients or some letters written, or if you don't have them, you can get them to write in front of you and see whether the sentence is grammatical. So this is a thing that you are going to test in the MMSC also, asking something to write a sentence, complete sentence. You check whether the grammar is correct. The affected areas are the anterior portions of the language network, including the Broca's area. You know that the Broca's aphasia have language the grammar problems. So they have the anterior part of the language area network affected, including the Broca's area. They can have difficulty comprehending complex sentences where a lot of syntactical things grammatically there. So they find it difficult to comprehend a complex sentence, but the semantic knowledge is intact. Their single word comprehension is intact. So if they are shown object, they would be able to recognize, tell the function of it, but the statements verbally or in written, grammatically not accurate. There's another area which is called primary progressive apraxia. Initially, these things were categorized under PNFA or progressive non-fluent aphasia, but now the trend is to take this group out of the PNFA and name as primary progressive apraxia of speech, where these patients are grammatically correct. They can speak, they can write nicely, they are extremely good in writing, but they find it difficult to produce the speech properly. So they would say, like, I know what I want to say, but I can't get the words out. It is kind of motor production in the orobuccal region. Their writing and typing is very much preserved, so they tend to work on, even though they have the speech problem, and they might use assistive devices, something like speech apps in the smartphones or tabs, to communicate with others, because their typing is extremely good. In the early onset of the disease, other functions like cognition, the gross fine motor, gait are unremarkable. These people have damage to the cortical and subcortical regions that are closely linked to the planning and production and monitoring of speech. But their grammar and the writing is preserved, so their comprehension is preserved, so they are preserved in the Broca's and the Wernicke's areas. The point 9, the logopenic variant, we discussed that this is the commonest early onset Alzheimer's disease variant, and they have progressive decline in the language function with relatively spared memory, relatively spared episodic memory and cognition. The focal pathology is in the left temporoparietal language area, as you see in this diagram. The left side, the dominant side, posterior temporal and the parietal region is a commonest area which is involved. The locopenic aspects of this PPA are word finding difficulty, and they have hesitation in their speech because they are finding difficult to get the appropriate word. Also, they have reduced naming. And the most characteristic thing is they have problems with the repetition, especially the long sentences. They have reduced verbal output because they have finding problems with the word finding difficulty. So they have a very slower speech. These people also can have paraphasic errors, but their grammar and the word, single word comprehension is very good. The logopenic variant, there are some degree of episodic and visuospatial memory impairment that helps to differentiate from the other PPAs. Although they are not as to the severity of the extent in the Alzheimer's disease, impairment of a little, some impairment of the episodic memory in logopenic variants help you to differentiate it from the other primary progressive aphasias. The last point, the Lewy body dementias. Lewy body dementias, and again an umbrella term where you get the Lewy body pathology, the alpha synuclein pathology in the brain, and the commonest two types are the dementia with Lewy body and Parkinson's disease dementia. Now, briefly, Dr. Damith Lienege mentioned the Parkinson's dementia, where dementia occurring in the context of an established diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. So, the Parkinson's disease, the patient who's known Parkinson's disease for a few years, at least more than 2 to 3 years, with established diagnosis of Parkinson's disease, the secondary development of dementia is considered as Parkinson's disease dementia. In contrast, the dementia with Lewy bodies, usually they present with the dementia. They are dementia associated with some combination of fluctuation. So they have reasonably all right in some episodes, sometimes, and in certain times they are extremely deteriorated, and they can have recurrent visual hallucinations. So these patients are behaviorally disturbed. They can become aggressive with when they are reacting with their hallucinations, and they are very much known to have REM sleep behavior disorder because these patients having seeing neuroclonopathies. And you know, Dr. Damith mentioned in the non-motor manifestations that REM sleep behavior disorder is a common thing in Parkinson's disease. It's extremely, extremely common in Lewy body dementias, even than Parkinson's disease. And Parkinson's starting later, not at the beginning, or maybe with the onset of the dementia. In contrast, the Parkinson's disease dementia, PDD, where you have established Parkinson's disease, later developed dementia, where in the Lewy body, the dementia with Lewy bodies, DLB, where you have Parkinson's disease starting later usually, or maybe initial symptoms may start with the dementia. But then the dementia is the most prominent factor. They have supportive clinical features. What you need to impart to know is these patients, DLB, dementia with Lewy bodies, are extremely sensitive to antipsychotics. That means if you have behavioral symptoms, you have to think twice or thrice before putting an antipsychotic, because these patients can deteriorate with antipsychotics. If you want to put an antipsychotic, perhaps clozapine or quetiapine are the milder forms that you can use, but again, you have to use it extremely low doses. These patients can have autonomic dysfunctions. They can have constipation, orthostatic hypotension. So they can have falls, they can have urinary incontinence, and they can have hypersomnia and hyposmia. Again, it's another non-motor manifestation of Parkinson's disease due to alpha synucleinopathy. These things can be seen in Lewy body dementias as well. So we discussed the hallucinations and the delusions. Indicated there are sort of another additional biomarkers that you can use. You can do a DAT scan where you can see the dopamine uptake SPECT scan, which could be helpful to differentiate from the other dementia syndromes which are not having Parkinsonism. Like if you want to differentiate from dementia from Alzheimer's, this is a DAT scan, is a sensitive one. And there's another myocardial scintigraphy, MIBG scan, is also additional helpful thing to differentiate from Lewy body dementias. So that ends my talk. And the 10 pearls that I would like to highlight in this talk is memory complaints are not dementias. We discussed the worried well, the MCIs, and then the dementias. And then the point two, neurodegenerative dementias are proteinopathies, have anatomical predilection sites to the various areas of the brain, and hence clinical variability of the presentation. Point number three, cognitive assessment is helpful to phenotype these syndromes. Late onset Alzheimer's disease predominantly presents as an amnestic syndrome where problems with the episodic memory. Early onset Alzheimer's disease have very predominant non-amnestic syndrome, commonly the language and then the visuospatial problems, like in the logopenic variant, primary progressive aphasia, and then the posterior cortical atrophy. Behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia is the commonest of the FTD variants. Semantic dementia is the commonest of the primary progressive aphasia variant, where your the knowledge of the world words are lost, and the meaning of these words are also lost. So that is point number seven. Point number eight is primary non-fluent agrammatic PPA and primary progressive apraxia, initially clumped together, now they are separating out, where you have reasonable comprehension, but the production of motor speech is the problem in the apraxia, and in the non-fluent is a grammatically they are not very accurate. A logopenic variant apraxia is having word finding difficulty, and it has a Alzheimer's disease pathology, and it is the commonest young onset Alzheimer's disease. Dementia with Lewy body disease is the commonest type of Lewy body dementia, which usually associated with the seeing nucleonepathies. And that ends my talk here, and thank you very much.